So, good morning again, or good afternoon for those who are late. I will open the next session. The presentation will be given by Professor Brighenti and Professor Spagnoli, both from University of Parma. Title of the presentation is Review of Additive Manufacturing of Polymeric Materials. But before to give them the floor, I would like you to remind to write your name in the chat in order to have the presence. So, Andrea, you are ready?
Yes, I'm Roberto. I'm ready.
Roberto will start. Good morning,
Okay.
everybody. And I will continue and we will
It's
switch
up to
from
you.
one to every other. It's
Okay.
up to you.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So let me share my screen. Can you see my presentation?
Yes, I can see
Is it in a presentation mode or not?
No, no.
No.
No, not yet. This way?
Yes, now
Yes.
it's okay now.
Okay. So thank you, Lidio. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this second session of our winter school. Now we are going to talk about a quite different topic from the previous one. We are dealing with polymeric materials obtained through additive manufacturing. And so we are going to present you some aspects, some basic aspects also beyond the additive manufacturing technology, in order to have a broad overview of this topic. Of course, it's a very broad field of research, and we will focus on some aspect, some specific aspect that we are being involving into recently. Before starting, let me say a few words about our city and our university. We are from University of Parma, which is located in the northern part of Italy, as you can see here. It's a middle-sized city. It's an historical city, but with very beautiful historical monuments and buildings, and as you can see here. And we have a quite famous theater, the National Museum, and so on. So it's a pity that we cannot meet here because some activities of the Serum project are also planned to be held in Parma, but of course we have to face the pandemic crisis. And the Parma is also the European capital for the food safety. In fact, we have the headquarters of the European Food Safety Authority. And I think you all know that we are quite well known for famous foods like Parmesan cheese, Parma ham, and so on. Regarding our university, it is quite old, as you can see here. It was founded around 162 after Christ. So I think it's one of the oldest university in Europe. We have around 27,000 students, and we are organized into three campuses. The Science and Technology campus, where we are now, the Human Sciences and the Medical Sciences campus. And we have nine departments. We belong to the Engineering and Architecture department. Parma is a medium-sized university and is among the best university in the Italian ranking, as you can see, according to our performance in terms of research and teaching. Here is an overview of our scientific and technological campus. We have quite nice facilities and also sports facilities. So I think it's a very good place for the students to study and to share their activities. So let's move to the talk now. This is the outline of our presentation. As you can see, there are several parts. I'm going to present you some of them, and then my colleague Andrea will continue with the others. First of all, we try to introduce the, the topic and the objective of this talk. And then I want to give you some hints about the mechanics of polymers. Mechanics of polymers is quite different from the mechanics of, let's say, traditional material or crystalline material. So we need to take into account some aspects that are really important for the mechanical response that you get from polymers. Also, of course, those obtained from additive manufacturing. And then after this introductory part, we will move to explain some additive manufacturing technologies used for polymers. We will have an overview. There are several. And we are going to talk about the parameters that are more relevant in the printing process of polymers. Of course, our goal is to understand what is the role of each of those parameters in the final printed material. So we want to be able to control perfectly the printing process in order to get the desired property of the final material. This is very important in order to get the components that are suitable also for load-bearing applications, for example, or that are able to ensure a desired durability, for example, and so on. So instead of working, let's say, in an iterative way, so one try to print and then check the properties, and then you change the setting and you check again the properties. We are trying instead to use a more scientific approach. So we are trying to describe the physics which is behind the polymerization, let's say, or the formation of the material during the additive process. And so we want to be fully aware of what is happening during the entire process. And in particular, as I mentioned before, we are going to talk about two technologies. The first one is the SLS, so selective laser sintering. And the second one is the photopolymerization or stereolithography, as you normally commercially call it. And finally, we will have some brief conclusions. So let's start with the introduction about the topic. Why polymers are so important? Because they are very well diffused practically in every field of the technology nowadays. They are quite cheap, they have good mechanical properties. You can obtain a very broad range of mechanical properties out of them. And this is because of their particular microstructure, which is quite unusual with respect to other standard materials. And moreover, we have also to recall that the microstructure and the mechanical behavior of polymers is usually adopted also to mimic, for example, the response of tissues and organs. So it finds application, very important application of also in the biomedical field and in other biological related applications. And finally, we have to remind that polymers can be very easily printed. We have different technologies with quite different, let's say, mechanism of printing behind them. And so we are really able to obtain parts of any characteristic of any size, ranging from the macro to the very micro scale. Of course, we need to understand, first of all, the microstructure of the polymer, because as I mentioned, the mechanical response depends strongly on its microstructure. And so for this goal, I'm going to present some basic concepts on the mechanics of polymers. And later, we are going to present some additive manufacturing technologies used for polymers, and show some experimental outcomes in order to understand what are the importance of some printing parameters on the final mechanical characteristics. And finally, we will go deep into these two technologies that we are currently studying in our research group. So first of all, let me remind the fathers of the physics of polymers. I think they can be for sure Paul Flory and Pierre-Gilles Dejean, who won the Nobel Prize, the first in chemistry, the second in physics, for their studies on the chemistry and physics of polymers or macromolecules. And also the theory that we are using today for the mechanical description of this class of material is strongly based on their findings. They propose simple but very effective models to describe how the material, the polymeric material, respond to, for example, to mechanical actions. So we are going now to have a look to the polymer microstructure, to the concept of chain and the cross-link between chains, how a polymeric chain deforms upon an external stretch, and what's the energy related to the deformation of the chain. All those aspects reflect in the macroscopic behavior of the material. So I think it's important to start from this very micro scale viewpoint in order to understand better what we observe at the macro scale. So here we can see some picture of quite common objects that we encounter in the everyday life. The word polymer means many units, and so it is obtained by repeating several times simple units. Here you can find the basic unit, which is repeated, for example, in polyethylene or in polyvinyl chloride, PVC, or in polypropylene, and so on. So as you can see, there is a very simple basic element, which is called monomer, which is linked to other monomer, forming a long chain. As you can see here, this is a scheme of the chain that you can obtain by linking together all these monomers. They are quite similar, as you can see, but there is an atom here, for example. Here you have chloride and so on, which makes the difference. This is called substitute and give rise to a completely different material in the end. Another important aspect that we have to consider is how these chains are connected together, because the mechanics of the material comes from mainly from the degree of interconnection between the chains. And so I'm going to show you some in-depth aspects related to the response of an entangled network of chains according to the main physics phenomena that takes place. Here you can see some mechanical parameters involved related to some kind of polymers, the Young modulus. Of course, you have a broad, very broad range of values. Here you have the tensile strength, the elongation that you can get from the material before breaking, and so on. And here you have a slide that shows you this graph, how the stress and the strain are related for this class of material. You can range from, let's say, an elastic, linear elastic material for the more stiff polymers, up to quite different responses, mainly related to the elastomer class of polymers. So we encounter several definitions. We can say sometimes polymers or sometimes elastomer, but all of them share the same mechanics. So I think we can say generally polymer in order to include all of them. So if we have a look to the microstructure, we can see that all these chains are bonded together. We can have different kind of bonds between them. And the degree of bonding is responsible for the final property of the material. We have to distinguish between the kind of bond and the density of bond. So we can have very weak bonds, for example, among the chains, or very strong bonds. And we can have few bonds or many, many bonds. And in the end, you obtain a completely different material. As you can see here, for example, if you consider a thermoplastic polymer, it means that you have the chains very weakly interconnected together. While if you consider an elastomer, you have a strong bond between the chains, but the bonds are not many. And finally, if you consider a thermoset polymer, it has strong bonds between the chains and the bonds are, let's say, quite numerous for per unit volume of the material. So the microstructure is very important, and as you can see, give rise to this very broad landscape of mechanical responses, ranging from the linear elastic to the very soft and hardening response, as you can see here for the elastomer. Here you can see some application of this class, different class of polymers. Furthermore, we have to mention also that we have to consider the so-called glass transition temperature, which is a temperature below which the polymer behaves like a solid. So we are interested in working in this regime in order to work with the solid. Otherwise, the polymer is like a viscous flow, a viscous fluid rather than a solid. Okay, having said that, let's go into the polymer structure. So this is a scheme of the chains arrangement that you can observe in a polymer. You have several chains connected together, as I mentioned, with weak or strong bonds, but for our purpose, this doesn't matter. And the energy, which is the real important aspect that we have to determine, is the entropic elasticity energy. So you can observe here a disordered microstructure, quite different from the ordered microstructure that you have, for example, in crystalline materials. In crystalline material, the energy that you have when you stretch the material, for example, is mainly related to the stretch of the bonds between the atoms or the molecules. So you are transmitting forces among the atoms, while in the case of polymer, you are simply rearranging the chains when you stretch them. So you are not, let's say, stretching the bonds between the single monomers, but you are inducing a different conformation of the structure of the polymer. So you are, in practice, you are making the chains to align with the load direction. So you change the conformation of the microstructure. That's why the energy related to this kind of material is mainly an entropic energy. And when you stretch the material, you are making the chain to be almost all aligned along the load direction. So you are making a more ordered microstructure. And so you are decreasing the entropy of the system. So normally the system is in the stress-free configuration. So you don't apply any stretch, anything. You have the initial energy, and then you can start stretching it, and you are decreasing the entropic energy of the system because of this better order that you are inducing in the material. We have also come to consider that polymers are usually quite sensible to strain rate effects. So we are not going to talk about this today, but I think all of you know that we cannot neglect the velocity we apply the deformation to the material, because the response can be quite different, at least for some class of polymers. So just to mention this aspect, which is very important, but I'm not dealing with it later. So going down into the microstructure of the polymer, we can see that we have a chain. This is a scheme of a chain. You see that it is made of several segments. This is the monomeric unit that composes the chain. And these segments are supposed to be rigid from our mechanical perspective. These red dots are the connection between the monomers. And you can see here in some position, you have more chains joined together. So here is the final point of this chain, and this is the other end of this chain, because it is connected to other chains. And one of the most important parameters that we have to account for is the so-called end-to-end distance, which is the distance between the initial and the final point of the chain. The energy of the chain, the mechanical energy of the chain, is usually made to depend just on R. So if we know this distance, and statistically we are able to do this, we can know the energy of the system, the mechanical energy of the system. So we start from an initial configuration, which is without any stress. We say the stress-free configuration. The distance between the two ends of the chain is called R naught. It is, let's say, the reference configuration. If you start stretching the chain, of course, you are enlarging this distance here. You have the current R, which is greater than the initial length. And so we are able to relate this stretch of the chain to the energy stored in the system. A very simple assumption that usually is made in rubber elasticity or polymer elasticity is that the chain feel the same stretch that you are applying at the macro scale. So for example, if you are stretching your material two times its initial length, we usually assume that also the single chains are stretched at the same level. So this is an hypothesis which is usually made. It is very simple, but it works quite well. And so we are also considering this simple hypothesis to hold true throughout what I'm going to present. Regarding the energy, as I mentioned, it is related to the variation of the entropy of the system, delta S, and it can be easily calculated according to the deformation of the structure. So this is the expression. I don't want to get into the detail of this expression, but if you know the deformation applied to the system, F, for example, it is the deformation gradient tensor, you can calculate the variation of entropy, and finally you get the elastic energy of the system for that deformation. So it's very easy to calculate the energy stored in the network, at least, let's say, for not too large deformations. Because if you are stretching too much the chains, maybe something can be different. But let's say in a normal large strain regime, this equation is quite good. Another important and very simple expression that polymer physicist has determined is this one, as you can see here. So the shear modulus of the polymer is strictly related to this parameter here, which is the number of chains, of course, cross-linked to the other chains per unit value. So mainly the macroscopic parameter G that we are usually dealing with in our applications is simply related to the number of chains that are connected in our microstructure. There are other parameters like the Boltzmann constant and the absolute temperature, but these are constant, and for a fixed temperature, they do not play a role. And finally, we have to remind that usually polymers are assumed and shown to be almost incompressible. So the Poisson's ratio is very close to 0.5. So this expression, I think, is the key equation that we have to consider today, because this number here, N, so the degree of connection between the chains, is the main parameter that our additive manufacturing process is going to influence. And so in the end, our material will be different according to the different value of this number here. So going back again to the kind of bonds between the chains, I want to remind you some of them. The weak bonds, typical of thermoplastic polymers. You know that thermoplastic polymers can be easily recycled, for example, by heating them. You can go back to the fluid state, and upon cooling down, you go again to the solid state. And this is because we have weak bonds, typically ionic or dipole or van der Waals bonds. So very weak bonds that can be destroyed, for example, by providing energy to the system. On the other hand, when we deal with the strong covalent bonds, we have thermoset elastomer or thermoset polymers. We say elastomer to indicate that we have few bonds per unit volume. We can say polymers when we have many bonds per unit volume, but let's say the chemistry is almost the same. And so, of course, the kind of bond makes the difference regarding this behavior, but from our mechanical viewpoint, it's not an issue. So we are not studying, for example, now the rupture of polymers. So it does not matter how strong is the bond within the chains. We are just studying the mechanics before the appearance of any damage, for example. Of course, we know that we can have damage if we stretch too much the polymer or in some other cases, but the basic viewpoint does not take into account any failure in the microstructure. And so from our viewpoint, weak or strong bonds do not play any role for our mechanical model. So here you have a scheme of what happened to a single chain when you stretch it. So you start from the rest position, the stress-free position, you start pulling the material, and you observe that the chain, of course, elongates, for example, and you have a bigger distance, R, in the end. And of course, you cannot stretch as much as you want, because the maximum stretch is limited. And this practically comes from this picture here, where you can see all the monomer units align in one direction. So assuming that they are all rigid, of course, you cannot go beyond this maximum length. So the maximum length that you can reach for a chain is equal to N times B. N is the number of monomers, and B is the length of each one. And it can be easily demonstrated that the maximum elongation that you can get from your material is on the max is given by the square root of N. N is typically a number ranging from, let's say, 20, 30 up to 1,000 or 2,000. So you can have a number of monomers, quite broad range of numbers, but this is the theoretical maximum elongation that you can get. And we can easily understand why in some cases we can observe elongation up to 10, 15 times the initial length, without observing any failure in the material, at least for some kind of polymers. Here we have other scheme of what happened to the chain. Of course, here we have the rest state, and here we have the stretched state of our material. We are considering different chains with different initial end-to-end distance. For example, here R1 becomes R1 prime because of this stretch that I am applying to the material. But for example, if I have a chain which is completely closed, so it is a closed loop, you cannot observe anything from the chain. So the chain changes its shape, but the end-to-end vector still remain equal to zero. So this chain here is not contributing according to the physics of polymers to the energy of the system. So only the chains who are modifying their end-to-end vector are going to contribute to the energy. Otherwise, they are neglected. This is a very simple scheme, but it represents quite well the real behavior observed in polymers. And here again, we have the expression of the energy stored in the material. Here, for example, if you want to use the principal stretches, you can easily write down this expression that is practically the so-called Neokean behavior of the material. So if you derive this energy, you find the classical standard Neokean stress-strain relationship. So let's see again what happened when we stretch a chain. This is the initial chain. We start pulling the chain with the force F, and we observe that we are going to make all the segments to be nearly aligned along one direction. So in the end, so since all our segments are rigid, of course, we expect the force to rise abruptly when you are reaching the maximum elongation. In fact, if you check and if you try to make an experiment, in some cases, if you are going close to the maximum elongation, of course, without any failure, you observe a stress-strain relationship like this one. So at the beginning, the behavior is almost linear. And then when you are approaching this straight configuration, the force is increasing very rapidly. Of course, theoretically, it tends to infinity because the segments are rigid and you cannot go beyond the maximum elongation of the chain. This is why you observe in some cases this behavior here. It is well described by the Langevin expression, which is typically used in the mechanics of polymers. This is the expression of the energy stored in the chain. And of course, you can obtain the force which is acting on the chain by deriving this expression with respect to R. R is the geometrical parameter, the deformation parameter, let's say, that governs all the behavior of the chain. And the shape of this function here, the Langevin function, is exactly more or less like the ones that you can observe from experiments. There are also a more simple scheme that can be used, but this one is quite useful and works for a very broad range of deformations. So after this brief introduction on the physics and the basic concept of the microstructure of a polymer, we move now to the technologies used for additively manufacturing polymers. We have several processes, as you can see here in this table. They can be divided in different categories and they work in a quite different way. So as you can appreciate here, we have some of them based on the, let's say, a mechanism of providing energy to the material in order to produce the final solid part. Or maybe you can have the deposition of some droplets or something like that. We can have a cutting of a sheet. And so the way the final part is obtained can be quite different. Here you can see the different starting material that you initiate from. So you can have a powder here, for example, when you deal with power bed fusion. You can have a liquid in the case of photopolymerization and so on. And so, of course, it also makes a difference in the end. Here you have a list of some of the materials that can be printed by using these technologies. And of course, you can span a very broad range of materials from very soft up to very hard and stiff materials. And finally, here you have the list of the principles upon which these technologies are based. Recently, within this project, we published a review on additive manufacturing of polymers. I suggest you to have a look to this paper that has been published in the Journal of Material Science, where we take into account, let's say, almost all the technologies used for polymers. And then we focus mainly on those based on the laser technology, because maybe they can be considered to be the most advanced and the most promising to get very complex shapes and of any size, and so without any limitation. This is the classification of the additive manufacturing technologies used for polymers according to the STM. As you can see, there are six technologies that have been, let's say, schematized in this technical rule. And maybe we can say that all the technologies available on the market can be framed into this list of technologies. Now I want to leave the floor to Andrea, which is going to present you the overview of this additive manufacturing technologies for polymers.
Okay, can you hear me? Thank you, Roberto. I'm going to share the screen, so just let me know if there is something not working properly. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, and is it in the presentation format?
Yes,
okay.
It is.
Okay, thank you. So, good morning, everybody. I will continue on the same line as my colleague Roberto has done, and I will try to give you some information regarding the different techniques which are available in the market for 3D printing of polymeric materials. As it was shown in the previous slide, there is a list of different categories where the techniques for 3D printing are can be placed. So I will briefly go through all these techniques, and then I will concentrate mostly on SLS, which is a selective laser sintering technique.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, Andrea. Okay. I think that the modality is wrong because I see the not the full screen mode.
Not why do you see a
like
bar?
Presentator mode? Yeah, I see that the right bar. I don't know if it's a problem you are all experiencing.
I experienced the same with Roberto, actually.
Okay.
What do you mean? Do you see a bar in the bottom of the screen?
No. I see. No? You know the.
No, we see the next slide.
We see the little slide, okay. And then okay. It's.
Let me.
Yeah.
I can do maybe like this. Hold on a second.
You can.
What about now? Is it any better?
No.
The same?
You need to stop the share and after to select only the presentation.
Okay, without. A presenter visualization, I think.
Yes, without. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'll start again. Let's see. No, why not this? Maybe it's better to share the screen, not the window. I'm not sure.
Yes, I think it's better to share the screen.
Let me see. But I think it's not.
I think you can first start the presentation and then share the screen.
Ah, okay. I did the other way around. Okay. And do you think it's better to share the screen?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. What about now?
No, it's all correct.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Sorry, I apologize for the inconvenience, but I hope now it works properly. So I was telling you that I want to briefly go through the technologies available for printing, 3D printing polymeric materials, but I will concentrate on SLS mainly. And my colleague Roberto will talk about SLA technique later on. So the first group of techniques is based on powder bed fusion. So the principle is of this technique is the selective fusion and solidification. The raw material is in the form of powder. And basically the particles are heated and then selectively fused by a heating surge, which is given by a laser beam. So one of the advantages of these techniques is to give good mechanical properties, fairly isotropic behavior of printed material. But on the other hand, there are disadvantages related to porosity and roughness of the surfaces, which, as I will show you later on, are very important in the mechanical performances of a printed material. Let's see if I can move on. Okay, this I will skip this slide because my colleague Roberto will talk about this technique in detail. And then I go to this class of techniques which are based on material extrusion. So the raw material is solid. The principle, the physical principle is that of extrusion of a melted material through a nozzle and a solidification. So this is one of the advantages of this technique is the low cost, and so it is a very accessible technique. But on the other hand, there are disadvantages related to the high anisotropic characteristics of printed materials, the high resolution. We are talking about 200 microns. And what else? Well, this class of techniques are also named FDM. Surely you have heard of it. Fused deposition modeling or FFF, fused filament fabrication. And then there is material jetting. Material jetting is a technique where the raw material is in form of liquid. There are heated droplets, and then through a photopolymerization principle, we have solidification of liquid resin to obtain the printed material. The advantage is that in comparison to the, for instance, the FDM, material jetting is rather fast. It allows multi-material printing, is highly accurate. We go to a resolution down to 25 microns, and it can produce very homogeneous specimens. But on the other hand, there are disadvantages related to the limited strength, photosensitivity of printed parts, and of course, a high cost of technique. Binder jetting, it's again a technique based on raw material in powder form, but now the bonding between particles is made by a liquid ink. instead of sintering as in SLS. The resolution is fairly good. It is a fast technique. It allows a room temperature binding, but on the other end, the use of powder makes a certain limit in the resolution, and so they produce rather rough surfaces, and this has an impact on the mechanical properties. And finally, I want to mention this sheet lamination, where there is an adhesion layer by layer of thin sheet of material, followed by laser cutting. So one of the problem of this technique, which is largely used for metals, but also in polymers, is the fact that you have a waste material when you are cutting each of the layer, each of the sheet in the layers. And the rather poor resolution which can be obtained is also to mention as a disadvantage. Okay, now what I would like to stress here, I will probably give you too much information, so I'm in advance apologize for that. So I won't be able, because of time, to go into the details of a single aspects, but still I would like to convey you the message that the additive manufacturing process parameters are very important in the final results of the printed component. So in the characteristics of a printed component. So it's important to have a quantitative view on the physics of the different processes which take place during 3D printing of polymeric materials. When I'm talking about the desired characteristic of a printed component, I'm listing here a few. One point is, of course, the load-bearing capacity. So the mechanical properties under static or fatigue loadings are very important and are one of the target that we want to achieve with 3D printing. Surface quality is very relevant, hardness and wear performance, and in some applications, like in biomedical applications, sometimes is relevant to control the porosity of the printed component. So what I would like to do now is to focus particularly on mechanical properties. And the question is how mechanical properties of printed material are influenced by raw material, first of all, so the type of polymer that we are selecting, and the printing parameters. Well, my colleague Roberto mentioned our recent review paper on the Journal of Material Science. It's really a review paper, very comprehensive, where we analyzed nearly 200 papers in the literature. And we realized that there are a lot of experimental approaches which can give you some empirical correlations between printing parameters and mechanical properties. But these approaches, in our view, cannot give you really a quantitative predictive tool, and they are not able to understand and to explain all the reasons of the differences in the mechanical properties of the printed objects. So I will now concentrate mainly on simulation. So which is to say, I would like to give you some hints regarding the modeling of the printing process. with reference to the SLS technique. But also I will give you, first of all, some overview of experimental results regarding the mechanical performances of printed objects. So what are the key process parameters? There are common parameters, which are layer thickness. Every printed object is made layer by layer. So the thickness of the layer is very important. The raster orientation, which means how the source of printing can be the nozzle or can be the laser beam is moving in the layer plane, and the building orientation, which is along the z-axis. So for in our notation, x and y are always the layer where we identify the layer plane. And then there are specific parameters which are related to the specific technique used. For instance, the nozzle temperature in FTM, the laser energy irradiated in SLA and SLS, and for SLS, the powder particle size. So without going into details, I just briefly summarizing results taken from the literature for FTM. For instance, there are evidence in the experiments that the raster orientation plays an important fundamental role in the mechanics, in the mechanism of failure when we are loading in the plane of a layer. But also there is an influence in the layer due to the layer thickness and the nozzle temperature. So I'm not discussing the results, but I want just to pick up these main parameters. When we go to binder jetting, there are raw material in powder, and so the powder diameter and powder shape plays a role. But also the binder, the type of binder, and the level of binder used in the process, as well the processing treatments. So there are results in the literature where we also are considered effects of layer thickness. And so increasing layer is so smaller layer thickness is better, basically, from experimental findings. And of course, increasing binder saturation is better in terms of tensile and flexural strength. Now, I want to maybe, I noticed that I'm running out of time, but maybe Roberto, you will stop me at some point. It depends really if we have to be strict to the 1 p.m. finish, or we can go a little bit further. But anyway, I will spend this last few slides regarding the selective laser sintering. I'll show you some experiments and a few slides regarding the models. Of course, we will need a lot of time to go into the details, but I just want to show you the path and the physics involved in the selective laser sintering process. So this is in the bottom left-hand side, there is a schematic of a building chamber. So we have powder, the roller is moving the powder layer by layer on the build compartment. Laser is hitting the powder surface through a scanning mirror, which is moving. And so is in a selective manner, is supplying energy to the powder surface. And then the plate in the build compartment is moving downward when each layer has complete its printing task to the next layer. there are key geometrical parameters of a laser beam, the beam diameter, the scanning space S, and I will talk about that later on. Well, here is just a list, which is very vast, of polymeric materials that can be used in SLS technique. But what I want to stress is that there are in the market both amorphous and semi-crystalline polymers that can be used. Most of the polymers used for SLS techniques are based on semi-crystalline microstructure, like the PA, the polyamide. And this is a rather important aspect to be taken into account when we look at the sintering and sintering process taking place. Here is a schematic view of what are the large number of characteristics which are relevant in the final results that we obtain with printing. So there are characteristics that are listed here related to the raw material, including particle dimension and shape. There are a number of parameters related to the process. And these are a list of physical quantities which are relevant for the final achievement of mechanical performance. So these are density, crystallinity, surface roughness, relaxation, residual stresses, just to mention a few. So all this link between raw material, process parameter, final part, and mechanical performance is something that can be achieved in an empirical way using experiments or using simulations, and so computer and theoretical models. One of the key aspect is the energy supplied during the sintering of the powder. So this can be measured in terms of surface energy density, which is depending on the laser power, the scan spacing, the scan velocity, or can be also measured this supplied energy in terms of volumetric energy density. And this expression includes also the layer thickness. So when we supply energy, we are activating in a selective manner the process of sintering of the powder. And so what we have seen from experiments by looking in details in the literature, there is an optimal energy density which control the apparent density of the printed component. So if we are going in a range of too low density, energy density supplied by the laser, we have incomplete sinterings and so a large number of voids. But on the other end, high energy density means thermal degradation of the powder. So there is an optimum level of energy densities to be supplied. And this can be shown in the results, experimental results. For instance, this plot shows you the apparent density, which depends on the void fraction, as a function of the energy density supplied by the laser source. And so we have we reach at a certain point an optimum level of apparent density. Bearing in mind that apparent density, as I'm showing here in this slide, is very much related to the deformability properties of the printed component and on the ultimate resistance of the component itself. So it seems that there is an optimum level of supplied energy to be given. to achieve a maximum level of stiffness in the component, and in a maybe a less evident level, there is also an optimum level of energy density in terms of ultimate stress and elongation at break. I'm sorry if I'm going fast and I'm not discussing the single experimental results. It would take too much time, but I hope you have at least the opportunity to get some clue of what is the effect of energy density supplied on the mechanical performances. And of course, although the anisotropic features are not so evident in SLSS as in FDM, there is still an effect of rastering orientation, which plays a role in the response, mechanical response of a printed component. Well, these are some aspects. Again, I don't have time, but if you want at the end, of course, I'm open to questions and you can have a look at our review paper, and also maybe we can share this presentation if you want. But again, these graphs are showing experimental findings relating the ultimate properties in terms of strength of components under uniaxial or bending stress as a function of energy density. So again, this is for stressing the fact that energy density is really a key parameter in the printing process of SLS objects. These are some results that I won't discuss by my colleague Livio Marsavina and co-workers. And also just to mention it, as CIRAM project is very much concerned to the structural integrity, there are evidence of effect of supplied energy by the laser beam on fracture properties like fracture toughness. Let me say a few words, although maybe this is the toughest part of my presentation in terms of theory and concepts behind, regarding simulation. So when we are dealing with simulations tools of selective laser sintering modeling, we can identify three steps. Basically, there is a stage of powder spreading, and so there are models for powder coating which are not treated here. Of course, you need to study the dynamics and the mechanics in general of particles movement under the roller action. And then there is the step related to energy absorption and heat transfer. And there are models based on optical and heat transfers. And then there is the sintering and cooling stage, and there are models based on the sintering, modeling the sintering process. Well, all these, at least the step two and three, are interconnected. So there are there is a coupled problem, but and this has to be one have to bear in mind this point. And then when we have obtained the printed component after the cooling stage, we can treat the mechanical models. So optical models, I'm picking up just a few points. Here we have the energy source of laser beam, which is hinting the surface of the powder. So we have a certain distribution of energy on the surface, and there are laws like the Lambert-Beer law to describe the energy absorption in the medium, so along in the depth along the Z direction. This is very important because this heat flux density will be a source parameter, source quantity in the following equation of a heat transfer of heat conduction. So this is a fundamental equation to describe the transient response, thermal response in the powder. And as you can see, there is a volumetric heat term generating the energy inside the powder. Of course, there are boundary conditions related to radiation and convection, but if we concentrate on the volume heat generation, what we can say, and this is a very important point, is that this heat generation is a combination of laser heat flux, so it depends on the source of heating, but also it involves latent heat because there are phase transformations in the powder material. So there are melting and crystallization. So this is really an important aspect. And we, of course, this crystallization is relevant when we are dealing, which is the last, the greatest majority, with semi-crystallized polymers in the printing. I don't have time to go into the details here, but what I want to stress is that if we look at this plot, there is a kind of hysteretic behavior between melting and crystallization of crystallized part of a polymer. And so this requires to work in a certain range of temperature during the sintering process. And this is very important because ideally we should have a crystallization only when the object is printed, but actually crystallization might take place during printing. And so at the end, we might reach different degree of crystallization depending on this phenomenon. I want to mention the other step in the modeling, which is the simulation of the sintering. A simulation of sintering can be done either using empirical relations. And for instance, here we have an evolution equation of apparent density, which depends on the temperature field T. This is working in a continuum level, but there are also approaches and models based on particles modeling, let's say. And for instance, there is this old model of Frenkel, where it is studied the sintering of two spherical particles. And in this case, we have the surface tension, which is the driving force, and the viscosity, which is the dissipated element in the process. So one way to deal with the sintering of the powder particles is using this model of Frenkel, but of course there are many others, more recent models in the literature dealing with the solidification process, so the transition from powder material to sintered material. And then at the very end, we have also models able to describe the evolution of the dissolution of bubbles. Let me just stress again with this slide the fact that it is very important to simulate the coupled problem of thermal conduction in the material together with the simulation of the evolution of melting, sintering and crystallization of the material. All these aspects all together in a coupled way, they make an effect in the final product, and they produce, they have a role in the final porosity of a component, and in the degree of crystallinity in the printed component, of course, when we are dealing with semi-crystalline polymers. So I don't want to take more time to my colleague Roberto Brighenti, so I will probably stop here. Just to remind again that, of course, these two aspects of porosity and crystalline phase are really fundamental and are the outcome of the simulations of the printing process. And as I said, they are fundamental in affecting the mechanical response of the printed component with SLS technique. Okay, I think I stop here, otherwise I'll running really out of time. But if you have questions, maybe later on or in the afternoon, we can discuss in more details. Okay, Roberto, please.
Yes, can you unshare the screen?
Yes, yes. Okay.
Okay, thank you. Okay, here we are. So let's go on with the last technique that we are considering, which is the stereolithography based on the photopolymerization technology. This process is quite complex and necessarily requires to consider some chemical aspects that I'll briefly show you. So there are many materials that can be printed with this technology. It's a quite advanced technology that allows us to obtain very precise objects. So the geometrical definition is very, very nice. And we can obtain, as I mentioned before, objects of very different scale size. So mainly we are starting from a liquid monomer. It's usually a resin. We spread UV light over this vat containing the liquid solution, and we start inducing the polymerization of the material. So we are start creating chains between the monomers in order to get a final solid material. So we can have stereolithography. We mentioned this technology at the beginning. So we have a laser light beam which is moving on the top of this liquid surface. And we are solidifying in practice layer by layer our object that we prepare with a specific CAD file. But on the other hand, we can have also another technology, which is called digital light processing, DLP, which is different since it works by spreading let's say, the entire layer in one shot over our liquid monomer. So we are not moving a single laser beam, but we can get in one single shot the entire layer, so we can print more quickly our final part. So the parameters involved in this technology are mainly the layer thickness, the post-curing time, so the time we use for inducing the solidification of the material, and the building orientation. In literature, you can find several outcomes that outline the importance of these parameters. So the different layer thicknesses, different curing times, and so on, in order to get the final mechanical properties. Here you can see, for example, some numerical results related, some experimental results related to different parameters involved, like the layer thickness. As you can see here, if you print with the smallest layer thickness, you get the better mechanical properties, like the yield stress or the ultimate tensile strength, and so on. So it's very important to not use too big layers when you are printing your element, in order to be able to polymerize as much volume as possible. And another parameter that we've also investigated is the velocity of printing, as I show you later. Importantly, the curing time, as I mentioned, is the time that we devoted to polymerize the material. And so if we are polymerizing too fast, we don't get the correct properties of the material. As you can see here from this graph, if you adopt a quite long curing time, you get the better performance of your material. If you are moving too fast, if you are not using the necessary amount of time to photopolymerize the material, you won't get the desired properties. So, of course, not in any case you can set this parameter, but we found that it is very important, and it gives you completely different materials at the end. Regarding the building orientation, several experimental tests have been done. We can say that it is not so important, because if you print the material in different ways, for example, as a flat edge or upright, and you look at the performances that you get, you can see that they are not so different. So probably this technology is not providing a material which is really anisotropic, but we can still have an isotropic material more or less irrespectively of the printing way of your part. Of course, this is not still completely clear, but the experimental results, I can say that confirm more or less this conclusion. So moving to the description of the process, the key aspect, as I mentioned, is the amount of change that we are going to create into the material. And this amount of change is measured by the degree of cure. It is called degree of cure, we call it rho, which is given by this expression. And it is equal to zero when we are in the initial liquid state of the resin. So Cm is the concentration of the monomer. Of course, at time t equal to zero, everywhere you have liquid, and as the time goes by, you have some parts that become solid. So if you are looking at the point and you measure the concentration of the monomer at that point for a given time t, you can observe that the concentration of the monomer is reducing in time. And so if we calculate this expression, we are approaching one as the solidification proceeds. So there are several ways of describing this phenomenon from a quantitative viewpoint. Some works have been proposed mainly based on the phenomenological approach to the problem. So you have, for example, one differential equation that tells you how the material is going to become solid. On the other hand, there are much more scientific, let's say, approaches that are accounting for all the main phenomena involved from say, starting from the light spread to the surface up to the final change formation. So we are going, I'm going to show you some details of this mechanistic approach that allows you to really control every step used throughout the process. So you start from the fluid, you spread light, you start creating chains, and in the end you are obtaining the network that finally corresponds to the final polymer printed. So our main concern is how to quantify the degree of cure. So how can we determine how many chains are formed during our process? Since the number of chains, as I told you before, is related to the shear module of the material, we need to know accurately this number after a given time. And so we have to know how the printing parameters, mainly the energy that we spread to the polymer and the velocity that we use to move our laser beam, have an effect on the final degree of cure that we get. So this is the process from the chemical viewpoint. Of course, I don't want to go into the detail, but let's say very briefly, we have some molecules inside the resin, which are called photoinitiators, that are responsible for creating the chains and so for the starting of the network formation inside the material. So the light, the UV light typically is able to activate these photoinitiators, and the photoinitiators start creating the chains. So they are going to induce the monomer to join each other in order to get the chains and their interconnection. So in order to describe this, we need to know how the light diffuses inside the polymer, inside the liquid monomer. We need to know how the kinetics of the chemical processes is going to be done, and how the chains are growing, and so how our system is solidifying in time. So here is skin, you have a monomer unit, and so the process is more or less like this. You start from this initiation induced by the light, by the laser beam that you are spreading on the liquid, and you activate the photoinitiator. Here you can see this green guys here. This is the differential equation that tells you the rate of changing of the concentration of the photoinitiator. And once you have the photoinitiator, you can start having the free radicals that are responsible for creating the chains. So all the monomers start connecting each other and forming the chain of the polymer. So the monomer units are decreasing in time because they are consumed in forming the chains. This is the differential equation that governs the way the monomer units are decreasing because of the process induced by light. And so in the end, you start having many chains until you finish the reaction, when the chain stops growing, maybe because it encounters another chain, or there is a combination of different molecules that stops the chain growth. So this is very, very briefly what happened and what are the equations that we can use to describe the phenomenon. So regarding the simulation, so we have to know, first of all, the amount of light energy which is inside our liquid resin. So let's imagine that this is our vat with the liquid resin. We are spreading light from the top, and usually you don't have a point-wise laser beam, but you have a distribution of energy on the top surface of the liquid resin. And so you have to take into account also how the light is diffused on the top of this surface. Here, I'm showing you a finite element discretization of the domain, of the liquid domain, because we use this approach to quantify how the material is going to be solidifying into the domain. And first of all, we have to take into account how the light diffuses inside the medium. Here we use the Beer-Lambert law, but it's quite useful and standard thing, I think. It depends on the absorptivity of the material. So the material transparency it plays a key role in making the light going inside the material, the liquid material, and this is given by this parameter A, which is called absorbance. So if you have a resin which is not very transparent, of course, your polymerization will be limited. So this is very important, and of course, this is also a varying parameter because this absorbance is different from, for example, the liquid part with respect to the already solidified part, or maybe parts that are in the middle between the liquid and the solid state. So this parameter here is changing in time and is different everywhere in your domain. Of course, the spreading of light into the material is an instantaneous phenomenon, so you don't have any delay. It's instantaneous occurrence, so you can determine the intensity of light everywhere in your domain, and you can solve, let's say, a standard finite element numerical analysis to find out the intensity of the light inside your domain, and you can start calculating how many chains are formed. Here are some of the details about the finite element formulation of the light spreading inside the material. I don't want to give you any detail, but it's a problem in which you have two matrices here, and the unknown are the nodal light intensities that we are going to determine. Of course, here this term on the right hand side is related to the light that we are spreading to the surface. So it's known, of course, and it depends on the intensity and the width of the laser beam that we are using. So when we start spreading light, we start creating chains. Of course, you can get different density of chains, because it depends on the energy and the speed and the transparency of your material. And so in the end, you can get different polymers, for example, with short chains. This will be more stiff than this one that has less connected chains with the bigger length. So many short chains means to have a very stiff material. And finally, when we have the degree of cure raw of the material, and we are able to get this number point by point inside our material, we can relate it to the shear modulus. This is called mu here, but we usually use G because it is related to the number of chains created, so the concentration of chains inside the material, which is related to the degree of cure raw that we get before. So practically, once you have raw, you can find out everything you need for your material. Here you have the evolution equation of the concentration of chains at a given point X. So you start from the initial concentration, which is typically very low, let's say close to zero. You don't have anything at the beginning because you have a liquid material. And then you start increasing the number of chains per unit volume until you finish your process. Here you have some picture of our numerical simulation, where you can see what happened in the material when you are moving your laser from left to right here, by changing, for example, the speed you are using to move the laser. For example, here you are using 10 to the minus 3 meter per second. Here you are moving 10 times slower than before. And you can see that when the laser reaches the same position, you have obtained a bigger volume of material that has been cured after the same traveling, let's say, of the laser. And here in the bottom part, you can see what happened in the material at the end. So when the laser is in the final position on the right-hand side of this layer that has been printed. Here again, the plot is quite similar, but we are dealing with the shear modulus, not the degree of cure, but of course they are more or less proportional. So these pictures are more or less similar to the previous ones. And here we are outlining some cross section of our printed layer in different positions in order to check what's the distribution of the shear modulus along the thickness. So here, you can see along the thickness, it is made dimensionless here from 0 to 1. And here you have the shear modulus. it is actually made to be dimensionless because it is divided by the shear modulus of the fully cured material. Fully cured means that you have 100% of formation of change. So it's the better material you can, the best material you can get from your resin. And of course, if you are using, for example, a bigger light intensity, you can get a better material. Or here you can appreciate what happened if you change the transparency of the material. So this absorbance here, A, A1 or A2, two different values, are in practice inversely proportional to the transparency of the material. So if you have a more transparent material, of course, you get a better result in the end, rather than having a less transparent material. Of course, the true is in between because, as I mentioned before, the absorbance of the material is continuously changing in time. It is not a fixed value, but it is changing. And typically, it is in between these two values that you can see here. Here I have a couple of, let me check, of videos showing you what happened to the chain formation inside the material when you are moving your laser at this speed here. So it is 1 millimeter per second, rather than moving your laser with a much slower velocity, as you can see here. Of course, here is the time. You need much more time to reach the final position, but in the end, the material is almost all fully polymerized. So the quality of the material is completely different with respect to the previous one. Okay, and finally, let me show this last picture in which I'm making you aware of what happened if you are printing a material and, for example, you are not using the proper setting in order to make, for example, the printed part to be as much homogeneous as possible. Here you have a simple beam. You imagine to print it by stereolithography, and according to the energy that you use and to the speed that you use, you have a different distribution of the shear modulus inside the material. This is the fully cured material, so it is the perfect one. While in all the other cases, you are, for example, moving too fast or using too low energy to polymerize the material. And in the end, of course, you don't get the deformation that you expect because you have a weaker material, for example, here in the bottom part of the beam with respect to the top part. So the final mechanical behavior of the part could be very different according to the way you have printed the material. Here we have some results from literature, which are quite close to what we have obtained. And just to remind you that there are also more simple models like the rheological models that are trying to model what I have just explained. Of course, they are sometimes much more phenomenological, but they provide also a good result. Of course, in our case, we are able to control everything, every aspect, and so we are really fully aware of every phenomenon which is taking place inside the material during this process. Very lastly, I would you to notice this very, very new technology, microstereolithography, which has been patented very recently and that allows you to get very small parts with absolutely incredible precision, as you can see here. It can be used to build the object by using the technology of typical of DLP. So in one shot, you get one layer of your material and you can obtain material of very different quality. You can print multi-material parts. You can obtain functionally graded materials because according to the intensity of the light, you are going to form more chains in one zone with respect to another. You can have 3D microstructure. You can print also active materials. So I think it's the very the very top level of photopolymerization technology that is available today. So with that, I want to conclude my talk. I hope you enjoy what we have talked about, and yes, some final hints that we can consider for further research. Thank you.
Thank you, Roberto. Thank you, Andrea. I would like also to thank you not only for this presentation, but for your support during the application of the project and during the implementation of the project. I get very great support from Parma. Can we have one question if someone want to ask? Because we are out of time. There are any questions for Roberto or for Andrea?
Hello.
Okay, Uroš, please.
Thank you for your presentation. I wanted to ask a question about the curing time. Do we cure the part after completion, or we cure the part after each layer?
What I have presented considers only the curing time during printing. We didn't consider the post-curing, but of course this can be done, and it can be very important to the final property of the material. Yes, sure, you are perfectly right. Sometimes you have a post-curing after printing the wall part, but of course this can be very different from case to case, so it's hard to model also the post-curing part of the process. So we just focus on the printing.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Welcome.
Okay, there are other questions? If not, thank you. Thank you again, Roberto and Andrea. So we'll have lunch break now. So we see you at 3 o'clock, 3 p.m. Central European time, please, Romania, 4 o'clock. We'll see you for the lecture of Professor Ludwig Kunz from Brno. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Livio. Bye-bye, everybody.
Thank you, bye-bye.
Bye.
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 Bye, thank you.
Bye-bye, thank you.
Thank you, bye.